Most likely, you are viewing this video because you have heard or read about Automation Direct's newest programmable automation controller, the Productivity 3000. In this video, we have the pleasure of our Programmable Controls Product Manager, Jeff Payne, explaining many of the Productivity 3000 software highlights. Join us as Jeff takes us from hardware configuration to using the bit and word histogram feature that could aid in troubleshooting your application or process.
Now, this is our Productivity 3000 Productivity Suite software. This is our basic layout and configuration. You can customize the layout of the design of the screen to fit your needs. By default, it's going to come with our application tools, task management pane, the instruction window, and then our ladder editor is the default layout. Again, you can unlock the layout and change the layout to meet your needs. You can tab and relocate windows to best fit your programming style. And you also have the option, once you get these into positions or out of position, you can go in to the tools and reset the screen layout, and it will bring us back to the default layout. If you lock this in, then it will not move. You can still select the Show Desktop. So once you have all of your configuration complete, Show Desktop, and it expands your ladder programming area. Once you get familiar with the programming environment, you may find that once your setup is complete, you don't need these windows as often, and you can simply pin these to the side. And then if you do need a feature out of these panes, then you can pull them up as necessary. Or you may decide that this is something that you don't need altogether. You can, again, customize this based on your needs. Okay, in this project, we're going to go through and start off, we're going to go and connect to the CPU. With the Choose Pack at the top of the screen on the toolbar, we'll bring up the Pack Connections window. And this will populate and give you the list of all controllers that you are currently connected to. If you're wondering which CPU that you're actually connecting to, you can actually have the option to blink the CPU display. If you know which one that you're connecting to, simply highlight it and hit connect, and you're online with that CPU. We're now in run mode. We will go to monitor so we can see our project. Hardware configuration is a window that allows you to go in and view your configuration. This is where you would also set up the configuration offline, or if you're online, you can simply hit read configuration when your system is in stop mode, and you can automatically identify the entire system that's connected to this. This also includes GS drives, remote bases, local bases, or expansion bases. In the hardware configuration, for manual configuration of your system, you simply take and drag a system into the configuration. So we've currently got, in the local base group, we've got two bases. We've got an 8-slot base, local base, with a 3-slot expansion. If we want to add a 5-slot expansion, we simply drag and drop that in the configuration and populate the base as necessary. Once you add a module to the system, you'll come up with a configuration window. These modules are automatically set up by default to be automatic module verification. This means that if your hardware configuration changes at any time, then it will give you an error. If you want this to be hot swapped or hot swappable, you can select the No Verification enable hot swap. This will allow you to remove the module during operation without shutting the system down. And so it aids you in troubleshooting for systems that are extremely sensitive to being powered off or shut down. This also gives you the default tag names for your discrete I/O points. When you add a module to a system, it's going to give you a standard group, base, and slot ID identification when you add a system, when you add a module in. This identification is going to allow you to be able to locate that module at any time. Now you can change this tag name at any point to a system, to a tag name that more identifies the I/O point in your system. This can also be done later through the tag database, and we'll show you that in just a moment. So adding a system, adding a module, again, each one defaults to the automatic module verification. And we give you the status bits if necessary, depending on the module that you're choosing. And then we also have peripheral devices. And in the peripheral devices, we can add GS drives. The GS drives and the DuraPulse drives are available to be connected to the remote I/O network when using the Ethernet adapter, the GSE drive. So if you take a drive and drop it into your GS drives configuration, it'll automatically ask for the drive number. You can say OK, and then it gives you all of the parameter options for the GS drive. This configuration is now stored within the PAC project, and you have the option of transferring this configuration to the drives every time you power up the system. This is very beneficial if you've got drives in an application and you're having to replace a drive on the production floor. You can take and swap the drive out, insert another drive, and now then you simply cycle power to the system and all of your drive configuration is installed into the new drive. As long as your system is up and running, you're online with the drive, you can hit read configuration and pull all the parameters out of the existing configured drive, out of the existing drive that you've got configured in your system. So this is very beneficial too. If you've got an existing system, you can tie your drive into the remote I/O network, pull this screen up, hit read configuration, import all of your existing drive configuration, and then it's saved into your project. Let's take a look at the tag name database. The tag database is another unique feature for the Productivity 3000 when compared to the existing Automation Direct controllers. All of our existing controllers are what's known as fixed memory processors. And so they have a fixed memory base that gives you an X number of, or a certain amount of memory that you have to work around. With the Productivity 3000, the tag name based system allows you to create memory that you need in the amount that you need it. So if you only need a few Boolean addresses, a few discrete addresses, but you need a lot of internal floating point numbers, or if you're doing a lot of process applications that require you to work with a lot of integers or a lot of timers and counters, you can create as many as you want. It's only restricted by the amount of memory that's in the controller, and there's 50 megabytes of user memory, so there's more than an adequate amount of memory. You have system tags that are in by default, and all of your discrete inputs and outputs are in the system by default. Again, these are listed as discrete inputs and outputs and Booleans with the default tag name that is listed for each module. Now, if you want to add a tag, you simply add tag, type in the tag name, identify whether you're looking for a Boolean, an integer, floating point, string, whether you're looking for a 1D array or a 2D array. There are quite a few data types available. If the integer needs to be 16-bit, signed, unsigned, 32-bit, again, float or string, we will just create a Boolean tag. And you can also select at this point whether you want it to be retentive or have an initial value. And you can also assign a Modbus address. And if you want to create multiple addresses, you can start off with a new tag with a number value at the end. If you want to create 50 consecutive tags, then we will add and close. And we will scan our Booleans. And here's our new tags. So we started off with new tag 1, and we created 50 consecutive tags.